So last time along, I gave Kingsford Smith a bit of a rough time. He was a reckless aviator. He did waste his time and money and spent a lot of it on boom. But he came to Western Australia and he changed his ways. And a lot of people don't appreciate this. And I, a bit like Shelley, I've been going through what I can, digging into this bloke. And I think that he did a pretty good job over here, even though he relaxed every now and then and spent a bit of money on booze and so on. But in the background of it all, he was doing a good job and he was respected by Brearley. So, but that is the background. Let's have a think about him. Brearley won the contract in September 1921, and the service was due to start 3 months later. And he had a lot of work to do. He'd already done a lot of work. In fact, he'd been to Melbourne, where the aviation, Civil Aviation Board was, and given them many ideas on how to set up the West Australian airmail service. But there was so much to be done. He needed to check on the aerodromes that were going to be used. He was so busy doing other things, he didn't get a chance. The contract was to provide hangars at various places along the route. He hadn't had much of a chance to get into that as well, and of course he needed ground staff. He needed aircraft. And what he had done was he'd set up a company called Western Australian Airways, and people had promised money to him, but the closer it got to the contract, the more of them dived out of the contract and he was short of money. So he had to go to the federal government and say, can you advance me £8,000? And they said, no, they're not interested in that. So he said, I'll get a guarantee from H.V. McKay from Sunshine Harvesters. And H.V. McKay came good. So Brearley was allowed to proceed. But right up until the middle period of that, he didn't know whether he was going to get going or not. There were two avenues for the government to follow. One of them was either a private contract, and the other was use the Air Force. And the Air Force were very keen on this. They were just being set up. We didn't even have it. It was an Air Corps at the time. They were keen on providing this mail service, and their argument was they'd have a series of airstrips along the West Australian coast, which would be a benefit for the defence of Australia. And so that was the aircraft that they intended to use. They said they would need 12 aircraft and 7 pilots. They needed 12 landing grounds and 8 emergency landing fields. This was very expensive. In fact, they needed £86,000 for their first year's operation. Brearley had come in with the idea that he could run the airmail service for £25,000. So you know which way the government went. £25,000, thank you very much, Mr. Brearley. And it was worked out by 1,200 miles north, 1,200 miles south, for one mail service to be done 7 days a week. So you multiply the distance by 2, then by 7, and then by 52, the number of weeks in a year. And of course, Brearley said that he could do it at 4 shillings a mile. Pa-ching, up came £25,000. If you look at the figures there, the Air Force had quoted something like 13 or 14 shillings if you do a backward calculation on that. And the Air Force said, well, that's pretty good because in England they're charging 16 shillings a mile. And of course, Brearley's 4 shillings a mile looked excellent. So Brearley then tested, advertised for pilots, tested them at Point Cook, and selected what he thought were the best pilots in Australia. Maybe he got the best, maybe he didn't. In this photo, first of all, Kingsford Smith. Next one, Bob Fawcett. Bit doubtful. He'd only flown 3 hours in the last year or two, so he wasn't what you call a current pilot. In the middle, Norman. And then Len Taplin, a very good and experienced pilot flying in the Middle East, and Val Abbott, a lawyer on the staff of Norman Brearley. And so he served a dual purpose, a standby pilot and a lawyer. And of course he was going through the fine print in the contract that Brearley had signed for his $25,000 contract. Pilots were on £600 a year, which is what they're being paid in Europe. And I think I finished last time when we were talking about Charles Kingsford Smith, that Brearley tested him and said that he was outstanding. I still stand by the fact that Brearley didn't do a backward check on him and discover how reckless he was and how that he wasn't insurable in the eastern states. He had so many accidents, what he'd been drinking and so on. And Brearley said there was no room for intemperate pilots. Well, he was biting off almost more than he could chew there. That photo is taken on the Esplanade before the show got underway, days before the contract started, the flying started. This aircraft didn't last long. It crashed on the first day of the service. This is half of a shed that Brearley obtained from Black Boy Hill. Oh, I'd have to say Grass Tree Hill, which was an induction area for troops in World War I. Sufficient for six aeroplanes, and the other half of that went to Geraldton, where the contract said there had to be room for six aircraft. There were stipulations as four aircraft in a shed, two aircraft in a shed further up the coast. All this had to be organised for the show to get underway. That's where the hangar was set up on the Esplanade, and that gives you an idea of what the aircraft looked like. It's got the cabin over the top, so there was the pilot up the front, and you could squeeze two people into that covered area. And so that was the aircraft type used for Australia's first airline and airmail service. This photo was taken on the 3rd of December, and if you remember back, the service was due to start on the 5th. So there was a day of celebration on the Esplanade. Vice-regal parties were there, people celebrating, people being taken for joyrides. And there was one extra pilot who wasn't there on the day. He was actually in Geraldton, because the service was going to be landing at Geraldton in a couple of days' time. And they hadn't had a chance to go up and check. So Arthur Blake, the missing man, was in Geraldton. I'll tell you more about Geraldton later on. He declared that the landing ground was totally unsuited to their operation. It turned out that the government, when they were looking at aerodromes for the Air Force service, said that the areas had to be cleared and suitable for landing and takeoff. And the way to do that was to clear the property or the area, the landing area, then plough it twice and then roll it, and that would make it a suitable landing surface. This had not taken place in Geraldton. The people hadn't read the instructions very carefully, which were mailed out from the Civil Aviation area in Melbourne. They'd cleared the area. They hadn't cleared it of mallee roots and other rubbish. They had built a 10-metre circle of stones, which was elevated about a foot or 300 millimetres off the surface. So in the centre of the landing field was this mound of rocks. And then adjacent that were loads and loads of scrub, trees, etc., which had been cleaned up from the other part of the field. So it was totally substandard, and what Blake did was go to a nearby farm, adjacent farm, spoke to Mr. Gould and said, could we use your paddock for our service, which is going to be coming in a day or two? And Mr. Gould said, yes, that's all right by me. And so that's where Geraldton Aerodrome got set up. It is still at what used to be Gould's Field. And so the three aircraft left on the 4th of December, circled over Perth and took off for Geraldton to establish themselves for the first day of the service. So there we are at Geraldton, and early in the morning, 7:45, they took off from Geraldton, three aircraft. Kingsford Smith wasn't on any of them. He'd been directed to go to Geraldton and sort out the mess. So for a bloke who'd been reckless and not very good over in the eastern states, he was now being given some responsibility in Western Australia. They went about 80 miles and Taplin's aircraft developed an engine problem. He landed in a paddock, and then Bob Fawcett overflew. Taplin was trying to tell him, give me 10 minutes. He was putting fingers up in the air saying, 10 minutes and I should be right. Fawcett made a low pass at about 50 or so feet, turned tightly, spun in. Both he and his mechanic on board in the back cockpit were killed. And so that was the start of the first air mail service in Australia. Brearley saw Taplin land, didn't see the accident, and landed in another paddock and learned the news when he got to the homestead. So that's the Taplin aircraft, how it ended up after the forced landing, very close to the trees and bushes with minor damage, very minor damage. And that's the crashed aircraft. The occupants of the aircraft were buried at the homestead. In fact, they were buried that night. It was a very, very hot day, and they decided they had to be buried straight away. And so then Brearley was going to give the whole show away. And he was talked into another go by his friends. And so he set off with Smithy and Hanson, his mechanic, to do a survey of the entire route. They left Perth on the 14th of December to fly north. Now you can see that Smithy was left at Geraldton earlier on to look after the problems that were there. And now he's flying with Brearley to look at the whole lot. So I think Smithy has been elevated in the system to a position of responsibility. So the idea that we left with last time, that he was a bit of a scallywag and couldn't be relied upon, maybe the story's changed a bit. The man at the top of the Civil Aviation Authority in the eastern states was made aware of the problems and he decided to come to Western Australia. He had problems getting across the Nullarbor with an engine malfunction and weather. He arrived late and that caused the delay in the departure of the first note up there. Smith, Brearley, Smithy and Hanson had to wait for Brinsmead to arrive. And when he got here, they took off. And the idea was that they'd go to Geraldton and have a look around. Well, when they got there, things were so bad that Brinsmead said to Brearley, listen, I've got to stay here. There's a hangar for six aircraft. It's got to be moved from the original site to Gould's Field. All sorts of things. The Shire's in problem, got problems here. And so Brinsmead, who was just going to fly the route and examine the landing fields, is now stuck in Geraldton trying to solve a problem. Brearley took off without him, landed at Murchison House to pay his respects and possibly a prayer over the graves. And Brinsmead followed later in the day, but what actually happened was he had an engine failure and he didn't have any means of communication. But he landed alongside of the telegraph wire, telegraph communication. So he got a pair of pliers out of the toolkit, cut the wire, and that gave the news that there was something happening on the section of transmission of the line between here and there. And so people went out to find him. Brearley had taken the precaution of carrying a field telephone in all of his aircraft. This was a unit as big as a very small suitcase with two wires. One wire could be thrown over the telegraph wire, used for communication between one town and the next, and the second wire had to be an earth. And the best way to get an earth was to have a pea on the ground, let it settle in, and then put the negative lead into that, and then you get good communication and chat away. They used Slater's telegraphic code. Does anyone know anything about this? It's a little bit like a dictionary without explanation. It's a list of words with numbers alongside of them. So instead of saying Kingsford Smith arrived before noon, you would look up those words in the directory there and take out the number and transmit that number, and that would give the code to the person at the other end. A similar system was used in World War I and World War II. And if you wanted to make it a bit more mysterious, you could add a random number onto the transmission of the day. So if you took the day of the week and added it to the numbers we first thought of, so that maybe 7 was added to every one, the person at the other end would know how to make the adjustment to bring it back 7 and get to the real word. They also had a code, which announced when Brearley was going to be arriving. This is, of course, later on in the scheme. And he was referred to as the green paint. That transmitted a message and say, the green paint will be arriving on Thursday morning. And everyone would snap to attention and make sure things were pretty good. So Brearley didn't carry a field telephone. On the way back, Brearley's aircraft suffered a severe oil leak. They had to force land on the beach just south of Broome. Hansen took off with the field telephone to tap into the system and ring for help, but he hadn't gone long when a stockman on a horse found him and then came back. They then established contact to get oil to the aircraft, which really wasn't going to solve the problem. They couldn't take off, the sand was too boggy. So there's Smithy and Brearley left on their own on the beach trying to sort this aircraft out while Hansen went away and came back again. So they probably got to know each other a little bit better during that joint effort to fix the aircraft up. They spent the day on the beach. They got very badly sunburnt. The aircraft, due to the roughness of the surface of the beach, had to be dismantled and was shipped back to Fremantle. So the party arrived back on, after leaving on December the 14th and having a rough time, ended up back in Fremantle on December the 31st. And I guess Brearley said to himself, I'm glad to see the end of 1921. Things can't get much worse. Remember the first time I talked about Smithy? He crashed an aeroplane on the Esplanade. 3 days after they got back, Smithy was flying off the Esplanade and crashed one of the aircraft. So one was wrecked at Murchison House. He only had 6 aircraft. Another one was badly damaged, if you remember the photograph. There it is. And that was the one that wasn't featured in any of the newspapers in Perth. Brearley had spent a fair bit of time telling people near flying safe, don't worry about it, you know, we're doing a good job. And here are these aeroplanes crashing right, left and centre. And Brearley was a bit concerned about it. And that photo came from the Call newspaper, who decided they'd publish it. WA Airways operated in a limited way before they really started again. And Smithy was the nominated pilot to do these first jobs. He carried passengers to Geraldton on January the 18th. He then flew north, looking at the airfields to see how they'd been restored or whether the improvements were suitable. And so he's now got a responsible job. Brearley's putting a fair bit of trust in him, I think. So he's doing the inspections, maybe the early start of the flying doctor service where Kingsford Smith may have, if you look at these last these lines here, maybe flew the first passengers on WA Airways on the 18th of January and carried the first flying doctor in Western Australia. The pilots, once the system got underway, had a fair bit of time. They only flew 2 days a week and fly a couple of legs from Carnarvon up to Port Hedland. It's two legs and back again. And then they'll have the rest of the week off. So there were tons of time for them to get up to mischief. Smithy was originally posted to Carnarvon. He became a celebrity in that he had a ukulele and a banjo and used to take them to parties and to the hotel, and he'd fire things up and everyone would be having a good time when Smithy was around. He became very popular, and then he decided that he needed to get around. One of the places that they stayed in Carnarvon was at the Gascoigne Hotel. Anyone been to Carnarvon and stayed at the Gascoigne?
Yeah.
That's the Gascoigne there. And the building on the side, that's the Gascoigne. And this one is what was called the bullpen. And that was upstairs, a series of 8 rooms, very small in size, with a single bed in them. And that's where they put the itinerant people that could have caused a few problems by having too much to drink. That could have been Smithy from time to time. On my first visit to Carnarvon, we stayed in the bullpen, maybe in the same room as Kingsford-Smith. So that gives you an idea of what things were like in those days. The refueling took place out of 4-gallon tins, had to be handed up, so it wasn't easy. And of course the uniforms that you saw on the pilots a while back certainly aren't worn, or weren't worn, while they were flying en route. Flannels. Remember those flannel shirts? Anyone remember them? Yeah. That's what they wore. Smithy got dengue fever in 1922. I'm told that dengue fever is about, if you imagine the worst flu you've ever had and then multiply that by 2, you've got dengue fever.
Yeah.
So he spent time in hospital and then back on the job. He purchased a motorbike. He never had enough money. He had to borrow the money from home. Even though he's getting 3 or more times the average wage, he couldn't save enough money to buy a motorbike. He had to get most of the money from home. So he used to be able to visit the people he'd made friends with while he was playing his banjo and ukulele in various hotels. If they lived out on a station, he'd be able to take his motorbike and go and visit them. Major number of them being female, I'm sure. So he visited friends far and wide. But apart from all that, he was appointed senior pilot in mid-1922. So Brearley was getting on fairly well with him. He wouldn't have done anything like that. Both were demanding people, and I think both had respect for each other. That's the Port Hedland hangar, room for 4 aircraft in that one. And they got up to mischief. This is a fairly popular photograph, but Len Taplin, was in Port Hedland, Broome, and they booked the aircraft up. He thought he had a seat back to the home port of Port Hedland, or his home port, and it got booked out. So the only way to travel was on the wing, not like United Airlines in America, where you get dragged off. But I believe that this one is well talked about because of the photograph, but it evidently happened on many occasions. The replacement for Fawcett was Keith Anderson. Anderson was an experienced pilot, and he and Smithy had very little in common, except for that when they had chats, they talked about flying the Pacific. Both of them had the dream of flying the Indian Ocean or the Pacific Ocean or around Australia or something like that. Smithy was an outgoing type, life of the party, and Anderson was a serious person who stood in the background, analysed the facts, and then would take the appropriate action. But he certainly wasn't anything like Smithy. They had made friends with Keith McKay. Keith's family had him put a fair bit of money into Western Australia. They had purchased a large station, 1 million acres, out of Port Hedland. They also had a dozen shops, 12 shops in Hay Street. And this made Keith McKay a fairly rich man, a bit of a playboy. And of course, Smithy liked to have drinks, and so did Keith McKay. The two of them spent a fair bit of time together. They discussed McKay providing finance for the Pacific crossing. And then there was an accident where McKay was killed. So that's the accident. The aircraft was flown by Lynn Taplin. Actually, he drowned. The tide came in while he was trapped in the aircraft and drowned him. That's the only photograph I could find of Marble Bar. And Smithy met Thelma Corboy, who came from Methena Station, which was out of Marble Bar. So that's the main street of Marble Bar in the 1920s, early 1920s. They married after a 3-day engagement. They knew each other for 3 months, but then the decision was made almost overnight, and they gave the postmaster at Marble Bar 3 hours to prepare for the wedding. So they set it up and away they went. And the celebrations went on for 2 days in the Iron Trade Hotel. That's a car from the adjoining station, how people got around in those days. Methena Station had a car of similar ilk. It was painted red and called Red Wings. And they used to drive around in that. Smithy used to ride around on his motorbike. Sometimes if you didn't have the motorbike, you'd get onto a horse. He travelled 60 miles to Methena to see Thelma on horseback. He wrote home to his people in Sydney and said, "I'm feeling pretty sore. I'm not used to being on a horse, and I've just done a whole day to get out there." So that was what he went through to get to Thelma. So that's where Methena Station was. Take the car and the horse from there to there. And there was a railway line through to Port Hedland, which could be traversed by a little four-wheeled arrangement with a stationary motor on it, popping along at maybe 5 or 10 miles an hour. So that was the means of communication. But once they were married, they set up home in Port Hedland. That's what the Methena countryside is like. Not very inviting. There is water in that creek there. And they got a reasonable amount of rain at some times of the year. The property to the east of Methena came up for lease, and Smithy was getting a little bit sick of flying aeroplanes. He thought he'd try his hand at something else. So he got the lease of the property to the east. After a short time, he realised he wasn't cut out for that sort of thing. So he handed it over to the Methena staff, even though it was in his name. It was the Methena staff that ran the show. And there were problems with wrongly branded cattle. You'll be able to see the problem when I show you the next slide. In fact, detectives decided to come up there and work out what the problem was, because the neighbour's brand was 010. Methena had a brand 01Q. Just another little burn, and you could change next door to yours. And when Smithy got going, the Methena mob decided that they could get a few more cattle by doing that. The I could be changed to a K. So this is what the detective was up there about. "Now listen, Mr. Smith, what's going on here?" Turned out that Smithy was able to say, "Well, I've been away from the property, I really haven't had anything to do with it," and he could substantiate that with his pilot's logbook, etc. And so the detective chastised the people from Methena. The pilots for WAOS Airways decided to apply for a pay rise. Really wouldn't have a bar of it. He said if he was actually saving, putting money aside for new aircraft. He knew that he needed aircraft with more accommodation for passengers, and that they were very limited with the weight they could carry of mail. And so he needed replacement aircraft. So he was stacking money up on one side, and the pilots heard about this and said, well, we'd like some of that. Most of the pilots were elected. By this stage, there was a staff of nine, or thereabouts. And most of them relented, except for Smith and Anderson and one other. And so they were sacked, simulated. They decided they'd buy into a garage in Carnarvon. It was owned by a bloke called Carlin. It wasn't long before they bought a couple of international trucks. They had Federal trucks and Rio trucks in the end. Speaking of trucks, did we say that your dad drove one?
Yeah.
Well, he did.
He drove the Rios.
The Thornycroft as well. Right, one at Carnarvon and one down south at?
Katanning.
Yeah. So they haven't gone to rust. And they still continued with their plan to fly the Pacific, even though they were in the trucking business. That was one of their runs. Carnarvon, Mount Augustus, through to Meekatharra. 19 stops on the way. And the station owners on the way were quite prepared to pay money to have a good service. And that was only just one of the runs, and there were many others that they developed. Because prior to this, there was donkeys, camels, and then along came the truck doing 20 or more mile an hour, 20 or so miles a day. It was a huge difference. Initially the company was called Kingsford Smith Carlin Transport Company. Carlin resigned, Smithy and Anderson took it over, purchased more trucks, and Smithy, who'd been spending a lot of time away from home while he was flying, probably never really knowing whether he was going to come home that night because of aircraft going out, because of mechanical problems and so on. And then he'd get into drinking sessions with his mates. And so Thelma spent a lot of time on her own. Trucking business didn't change anything because he spent a week away from home going on these long legs. In 1926, they sold the transport company for £2,300. A lot of money in those days. And they bought two Bristols from Brearley and flew them east. That was going to be the start of their new business, flying people, transporting people, mail, etc., joyrides in the east. In the background, their aim was still to fly the Pacific. They set up an office in Sydney. When they delivered the two aircraft that they bought from Brearley, they took two people with them. And Mrs. Marshall here became the first woman to cross Australia by air. So this is Anderson, this is Smithy, and this is Mr. and Mrs. Marshall. That was taken before they left Perth. That was taken when they arrived in Sydney. They didn't look quite as relaxed, did they? They had a tough time. Also added in here was Bobby Hitchcock. Anyone know the name?
Yeah.
Yep, you would have heard of Bobby Hitchcock. He was a West Australian.
Henry Smith Hitchcock.
My mother knew a Mrs. Hitchcock who was directly related to him. She wouldn't bear the name Smith mentioned in her house. Mm-hmm. And that's them as they got their new business underway when Charles Olm came along. So that's what happened in Sydney. Notice that Smithy is off the ground. He was short and conscious of it, and often stood on his toes while photos were being taken. And you see here that rather than stand with the rest of them and be a shorty, he'd jump up and look taller. There are a number of books, and this is some of them. This is on their Pacific crossing. These two are written by Charles Kingsford Smith. In one of them he doesn't mention Thelma at all, and in the next one she only gets the briefest of mentions. This book here by McCurdy gives a good rundown on Thelma. He actually was in contact with a member of the family who was doing a genealogical survey, and they interviewed her, and she had shut the book for 50 or 60 years on Charles Kingsford Smith. It was only in the last year before she died that she opened up and had a word to say about him. Thank you.